Hello everyone and welcome to EBTV on evolvingbeings.com. My name is Avita Oshel and with me today is special guest Paul K. Chappelle. Paul has served in the U.S. Army for 7 years, was deployed to Baghdad in 2006 and left active duty in November 2009 as captain. Currently, Paul is the Peace Leadership Director for the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation and the author of several books, namely, Will War Ever End? And the End of War. And his latest book is the newly released Peaceful Revolution, How We Can Create the Future Needed for Humanity's Survival. Hi, Paul, and welcome.
Oh, thank you for having me. We really appreciate it.
You're very welcome, Paul. Well, what we're going to be discussing today amidst your latest book, newly released again, The Peaceful Revolution, are some very timely topics that you touch upon that really is the whole purpose and basis of your work and your books. Because as we know, currently, there are mounting tensions in our world. We've seen, you know, in the last 100 years or so, the world go through some major world wars and some major, you know, various national and civil wars. And right now, of course, there are some hints that there are mounting tensions with various countries such as Iran and, of course, nuclear threats and so much more. So, from that perspective, to us as, you know, citizens of this planet, things are not looking great. And to a lot of people, war is just an inevitable part of life on this planet, and that's how they think it always was, always will be. So we're going to be talking and dispelling some of these myths, thanks to the wonderful work that you've been doing, thanks to the books and such, in terms of, are we really violent? Is war an inevitable part of life? And what are some of the solutions to really bring us up to living on this planet from a space of peace rather than war? So to begin with, you yourself grew up in a household where your dad was in the army, then you went to the army, and then you left the army and are today a peace activist. What happened and how did this all come about?
I think everything began to change when I was younger. I began to see things in my father's behavior that caused me to question the myths and assumptions that people have about war. For example, I grew up believing that human beings are naturally violent, that we're naturally warlike, it's a part of human nature. And my father was in the Vietnam and Korean Wars, and I saw how war had traumatized him. And I began to think when I was younger, well, if we're naturally violent, then why does war cause so much trauma? If we're naturally violent, why does war drive people to madness and to insanity? And if we're naturally violent, then why wouldn't people go to war and come back and be more mentally healthy? And why is war one of the most traumatizing things a human being can go through? If you're naturally violent, you go to war, your mental health would steadily improve, and you don't have enough war, and you would start to have mental problems. And I think that was the beginning of the transition. And then when I was at West Point, I read this book called On Killing, written by Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman, and he was a West Point psychology professor, Army Ranger. And in his book On Killing, which is required reading in classes at West Point, it's required reading at the FBI Academy, it's on the Marine Corps Commandant's required reading list, he says that human beings have a natural aversion to killing other human beings. And his evidence is simply overwhelming, looking at military history, that we're not designed to kill each other. And then I think that was the beginning of this huge transformation in terms of other things I saw and learned and researched and experienced that helped me realize that. One thing I tell people is that I learned at West Point and in the Army that world peace is possible. And I really think that what I experienced and learned in the military is what has made me so hopeful. So
it's really interesting to hear because I guess for most people, once they enter the Army, it's pretty much a dedicated, you know, lifelong vocation. But for you, there was obviously this particular shift that called you forth in a different direction. So in your work today, one of the things you've just also pointed out is something about human beings naturally violent and war being a part of life. For most people on our planet, and you know, many people I've spoken to myself, when topics like world peace get brought up, they do get brushed off. And I know you say this a lot in your book, and that as well, you know, people think it's unrealistic. It's like a fairy tale that war has always been here and it always will be because this is how humans solve their problems. What is wrong with this view?
Well, the view is very dangerous because if you think that world peace is a joke and it's naive, then how can you move in that direction? If you think that world peace is a punchline, mm-hmm. and anyone who believes in world peace is a naive idiot, and working toward world peace makes you a naive idiot, then it really creates a problem in moving in that positive direction. And we know that this is how most people see world peace. If we, for example, the movie Miss Congeniality with Sandra Bullock, there's a scene in the film where there's a beauty pageant. An interviewer asks the beauty pageant contestants what they want, and they all say world peace. And it's supposed to be a joke. And I've asked audiences, well, why is that funny in the movie? And then the common response is because the idea of world peace is a stupid idea. And if we want to go in that direction, we have to assert the fact that this is, in fact, possible. And I do that primarily by looking at human nature. And the fundamental question we have to ask is, are human beings naturally violent or naturally peaceful? And I think the best evidence we can use to look at that is actually military history. Military history provides overwhelming evidence that we're not naturally violent. And what more convincing source of information is there than military history, which is the conditions where people are actually in violent situations?
And I think that is actually a really good point to bring up also to share with the audience, because most people who are not in the army, who are not in the military, who have no firsthand experience, I think we think that the way things work is very different from what actually happens and how much conditioning and how much training goes on to actually make the average citizen go out onto a battlefield and risk their life and kill another human being, right? So can you, you know, touch a little bit upon that? Because again, most people's vision of that is, oh, well, you know, we're just proud citizens going to defend our country, but because that's what we normally would do. But that's not quite it. Again, a lot of training, a lot of conditioning, right?
Yeah, we have to keep in mind that violence is something that most people are terrified of. Most people are terrified of violence. At West Point, you have to take a mandatory boxing class. And every freshman male has to take a mandatory boxing class, and it's optional for females. And West Point's reasoning for that is that most people are terrified of violence. Most people are afraid to box somebody. I mean, if I were to go out into the streets and challenge a random person to a fight, most people would be frightened, especially if I had a knife or a weapon. And if you look in military history, the greatest problem of every army in world history is when a battle begins, how do you stop soldiers from running away? In combat, our flight response is far more powerful than our fight response. Most people's natural reaction when you try to stab them or shoot them, most people's natural reaction is to run away as fast as they can, as far as they can. Every general has to contend with the fact that you're trying to get people to fight and the other side's trying to kill them, and it's terrifying. And what I learned in the army is that the most effective way to get people to fight is actually this brotherhood and camaraderie and empathy between soldiers and this bond of love between soldiers. So it's very ironic and paradoxical that what makes organized warfare possible is the love and bond between soldiers, where if you see your loved one in danger, if you see your loved one being attacked, you will put yourself at personal risk to protect your loved one. And that's why every war in human history, the national leaders have to tell people we're fighting for self-defense and we have to protect our family and our loved ones are in danger. And when you combine that with brotherhood and camaraderie in the military, it's very powerful in terms of getting people to fight.
So it's almost as if you've got the right, you know, ingredients in place to then have these people that are soldiers to go out and, of course, inflict violence and kill other human beings, right? Now, as part of your work in your book, Peaceful Revolution, so many wonderful topics are raised by you as you go through the different muscles of humanity that could be our solution in terms of moving towards world peace. I'm going to quote something from your book. You state, instead of teaching us how to achieve our full potential as human beings, our society teaches us that hoarding money is the most important thing in life, and to survive as a global family, we must offer people a more fulfilling vision of what it means to be human, one that makes greed look empty in comparison. And that theme of what it means to be human comes up a lot in your book. Can you just kind of summarize for us, what does it mean to be human? What are we not getting?
That's a great question, and that's a very age-old question, where what does it mean to be human? Does it mean to be greedy? Does it mean to be selfish? Does it mean to be hateful? And you hear a lot of contradicting viewpoints. You hear this idea greed is good, or the virtue of selfishness. You hear this, especially with followers of Ayn Rand, that selfishness is in itself a virtue, and greed is a productive thing. And we have to show, what does it really mean to be human? What does it mean to be physically healthy? Yeah. Things like diet, exercise. And being physically healthy does not include things like heart disease or obesity. And being psychologically healthy does not include things like hatred, greed, selfishness. And I think we are at a point in human history where a lot of things that Buddha or Jesus or Socrates said about what it means to be human, we can actually verify with scientific evidence, mm-hmm. showing the psychological harm done by being hateful, being envious, being greedy, and also showing even the physical harm. Studies have shown that being hateful and angry, it lowers your immune system. It can have all sorts of adverse health effects. And I think that we have to show people what does it mean to be human, because trying to end war without understanding human nature, it's like trying to go to the moon without understanding the laws of physics. We have to understand, what is it to be human? Why did things go wrong? Why do people do bad things? What makes people want to kill people? Mm-hmm. And that's an important question. I'm not saying people can't become violent. Mm-hmm. People can certainly become violent. I'm just saying that we're not born violent, and there is a way to understand why people become violent, and there is a way to help prevent that.
Absolutely. And I think one of the points that you talk about in your book about why people become violent is being exposed to traumatic violence, right? And you yourself talk about your own personal journey of what effect and impact it had on you to have your dad be in the army, and what kind of a, you know, relationship, what kind of a foundation that set for you, correct?
Right. I had a violent upbringing. My father was very violent toward me, and I grew up in Alabama. And I'm half Korean, a quarter white and a quarter black. So I was around racism, and I was bullied growing up to some extent. Mm-hmm. And it makes you angry, and it makes you violent. And if you look at the violent criminal population, the vast majority of people in the violent criminal population were abused growing up.
Yes.
And there's a way to condition people to become violent through abuse, through trauma, through violence. You take a young child. You give that child love and affection and a healthy home environment, respect, and the child turns out usually mentally healthy. You take a child and you beat the child, abuse a child verbally and physically, bully the child becomes violent. And if we're naturally violent, then why does a loving home environment help our mental health so greatly? And if we're not naturally violent, then why does violence to children cause so much irreparable harm when they're adults? So.
Absolutely. And I think these are such core issues for people to be more aware of, because again, I find in our society, there's this glossing over of support our troops and go enlist in the military, right? And it's the nice and you know, honorable thing to do. And yet we're not exposed firsthand, for most part, for most people as well, to what happens during and after all of this, right? What happens to the men and women that come home after? What impact does this have on their families? What impact does it have on their quality of life, their health, mental, physical, emotional, spiritual, etc.? So these are such core issues that today we are waking up. We are willing to look at them rather than stick our heads in the sand and say, oh, no, war is just, you know, a natural part of life. So in talking about this, you know, in your book also you touch upon how the conditioning is set up, both for the average citizen who is outside of the army to support the troops, and both for the troops to enlist. And one of the things I found really fascinating, which I'm sure all of us are aware of, but don't really give conscious thought to, is the aspect that you talk about of dehumanization. How much of that has to take place? Can you talk a little bit about that and the other aspects that, you know, why war continues and troops continue to enlist and such?
Yeah, it's a really good point, really good question about dehumanization. And I can kind of build a foundation for that, where if we want to understand whether human beings are naturally violent, there's been books about chimpanzee behavior and bonobo behavior. And if you want to understand whether human beings are naturally violent, the best place to look is human behavior. Mm-hmm. And other books can add to that understanding, but we have to look at human behavior. And the best place to look, people look at anthropology, for example, and there is good evidence from anthropology, but the best place to look to understand whether we're naturally violent or naturally peaceful is to look, how do human beings behave in violent situations? How do human beings behave in war? How do they behave in battle? How do they behave in trauma and violent upbringings? How do people behave in the crucible of violence? And if you look at military history, one thing you realize is every war in human history, every single war in human history, without a single exception, requires dehumanization. Every war without an exception requires dehumanization. You have to dehumanize the other side. And this is done through what Lieutenant Colonel Dave Grossman in his book On Killing calls distance. And he talks about three kinds of distance. The first is psychological distance, which is portraying people as subhuman. So their crouch or their japs or their gooks, if you look at American history. And the ancient Greeks called all non-Greeks barbarians. And during the Rwandan genocide, over the radio, they were calling the victims cockroaches, or my father, the side of his family is African American, and I'm part African American. The most infamous dehumanization word in American history is nigger. Because if you want to dehumanize a group of people and sell them as slaves and oppress them and lynch them, mm-hmm. and kill their children or sell their children, you have to think they're not like you. So the word nigger is a dehumanizing word. The second form of distance is moral distance, which is basically evil. So the other side, they're terrorists, they're evildoers, they're gangsters, they're bad guys. We're good, we're holy, God is on our side, the other side is evil. And the third form is mechanical distance, which is the farther away you are, the easier it is to kill them. So it's easier to drop a bomb on someone at 10,000 feet than it is to shoot them with a rifle at 300 yards. Mm-hmm. It's a lot easier than stabbing somebody at close range. And if we were naturally violent, why would every war require dehumanization? And you look at war propaganda that works the same way in every culture, every time period. War propaganda has to tell the people that they're fighting for something good, like self-defense or ideals, such as freedom or liberating people.
Yep.
And the other side, they're inhuman, they're monsters, they want to come kill your family, and you have to protect your family and spread freedom and spread democracy or remove evil from the world. And it's very convincing evidence if you look at military history that every war requires dehumanization. And there's never been a war where a national leader told his people, these people are just like you.
Yeah.
Their families are just like your families, and you're going to go make widows and orphans out of people who are just like you.
Yeah, it gives one shivers to think that, but that's the truth. Like, we are all one human race on this planet who is acting still in such a childish, archaic way of trying to kill its own species, which, you know, by and large in nature, isn't that just, you know, madness?
Yeah, it's... if a species is at war with itself, it can self-destruct.
Yeah.
And you see other animal species, and there are exceptions, of course, but you look at rattlesnakes. Rattlesnakes will bite every other animal with their lethal fangs, but when they fight each other, they wrestle. Mm-hmm. And if you look at King Cobra will bite other snakes, and they actually specialize in eating snakes, but when they fight each other, they wrestle. If you look at buffalo or bulls or animals with horns, when they fight other species, they will try to gut the animal, they'll try to attack the animal from the side, or attack the ribs, or attack the stomach. Mm-hmm. When they fight their own species, they fight head to head, which is the least lethal form of combat. And in terms of human survival, it was much more beneficial in terms of human survival for human beings to be good at cooperation. And that's one reason why we have this amazing capacity for language. No other animal has the capacity for language that we do. And the reason for that is language greatly magnifies our capacity for cooperation, where we can really plan ahead and cooperate very effectively. And it also gives us a nonviolent way to resolve conflict, where other animals, they might have to growl at each other or snap at each other, but we can talk it out, where you and I have a conflict, hey, let's dialogue about this. Here's how I felt about it, here's how you felt, here's where we had a misunderstanding. And you think about the capacity that language has for resolving conflict nonviolently and for magnifying cooperation. And that's one reason why we're such a effective, powerful mm-hmm. species. And unfortunately, though, that cooperation can also make us more effective at war. And I think it's very uplifting in that when you realize that every war in history requires dehumanization, it's actually a very uplifting thought, because you realize this is not natural. You have to, in many ways, deceive people to make them go to war. And to me, the most depressing information would be the idea that we're naturally violent, we're naturally hateful, we're just born to self-destruct. But mm-hmm. the idea that all of this is done through deception and propaganda, and it's like a magic trick. You show people how a magic trick is done, they can see right through it. Propaganda is just like a magic trick. You show people how it's done, and they can see right through it. So we have to educate people on how the deception is being done.
Yes, yes, yes. I think those are such key points, deception and the illusions, for us to really see beyond that. Now, for people who are watching and listening, they might say, okay, well, I hear what you're saying. It's kind of making sense to me. But then if we look at our society, we seem to have this obsession with violence. If we're
Right.
not naturally drawn to it, right, why all the, you know, why are the violent movies the ones who get the top box office ratings? Why all this, you know, push and pull towards the violent video games and such? How can you help people understand that?
Well, that's a really good question. There's a few things going on. The first thing is that we are not naturally violent, yet we are biologically hardwired to stare at violence. So imagine a situation like this. Imagine if right now in the room you're sitting in, a bear just burst in the door right behind you. And will you turn around and look at the bear? Or will you keep looking at me? Of course you turn around and look at the bear. It doesn't matter what you're doing. It could be the presidential inauguration, but if a bear is running around the back of the crowd, everyone's going to turn around and look at the bear. And there's something more dangerous than a bear, and it is human-on-human violence. The most dangerous thing to us is actually a violent human being and human-on-human violence, because if we rely so heavily upon cooperation, think about how dangerous violence is between people in a small community. And so, zebra are biologically hardwired to stare at lions. If there's a lion anywhere on the savannah, every zebra has to stare at it. They can't look away because it threatens their survival. And as long as you see the lion, you're going to be relatively safe. Lions are most dangerous when you can't see them. Same thing with a violent encounter. If you can see it, you can kind of in some way protect yourself. And people, they react in all sorts of different ways. They might, a lot of people will try to break it up. Some people might try to call the police. Some people might just look and do nothing. But everyone's going to have to look at it. That's one reason, is that it's such a great threat to our survival. The same way zebra are biologically hardwired to stare at lion, we are biologically hardwired to stare at bear or any predator, we are biologically hardwired to stare at violence. You see a fight in the playground, everybody's going to look at it. Every kid's going to look at it. A fight in the street, everyone's going to turn around and look. Another reason, though, is the repression of something very new. For most of human history, sex was something that was common. If you live in an African savanna thousands of years ago and none of the women have shirts on, you see breasts, it's not a big deal. Think about an African tribe and none of the women wear shirts. Your mother, your grandmother, your aunt, your great aunt, your sisters, and you see breasts, it's no big deal. But when something becomes taboo or becomes forbidden, you start to become obsessed with it. So during the Victorian era, you had this sexual repression where women had their entire bodies covered. Sex became something that wasn't natural. It became something that was evil and forbidden and taboo. And what that generated was sexual fetishes and obsession with sex. And Grossman talks about this in On Killing. And he says a new repression, though, is the repression of death, where we live in a society where people never see death. If you lived 1,000 years ago, or if your parent died, or your grandparent died, they died in the home. Today, our relatives typically die in the hospital, but they would die in the home. And it was your job as a family member to clean the body, prepare the body for burial, and bury the body. And most people in America have never seen a dead body, and if they have, it's been decorated to look like it's alive with makeup at a funeral home. We no longer kill the food we eat, and we pretend that we're never going to die. You look at people, they get expensive plastic surgery to look young. They put their parents in nursing homes. They don't even want to look at older people. This idea that death is unnatural, we're not going to die. So what Grossman says in On Killing is whenever you repress a natural part of life, such as sex, it creates actually an obsession with sex, and it creates sexual fetishes. And whenever you repress a natural part of life, such as death, it creates an obsession with death, and it creates death fetishes, which is our obsession with violence. So if you see the repression of the idea of death, the idea that we're not supposed to die, that death is unnatural, you see this growth in obsession with really violent, gruesome media, because most people have never seen that kind of thing. And I think there's another reason, too, a third reason for the obsession with media violence, especially violent video games. If you look at violent video games, you're always doing something important. You have some big purpose. You're saving the world. Yeah, you're killing lots of people, but it's something meaningful, something with purpose. You have a goal, you have a purpose, you have a grand mission you're a part of. And it really, in our society, gives people a sense of meaning. Mm-hmm. And growing up playing violent video games as a kid, it wasn't just the violence. It was also the sense that you were doing something, you had a goal, you could accomplish that goal and do something meaningful, even though it was make-believe. You really get into it. Mm-hmm. The games were made to really draw you in. And the other thing, too, is the games are really fun, and it has a lot to do with the hand-eye coordination. You think about our early ancestors. They needed good hand-eye coordination. How would nature encourage us to do something that aids our survival? And one way is to make that enjoyable.
Yeah.
So eating fresh fruit, eating vegetables, tastes good. Loving people, being a kind person, makes you feel good emotionally, psychologically. So you're encouraged to do that behavior. And how would you make people want to practice hand-eye coordination? Well, you make it fun. So you look at so much of what we do involves hitting a target. Golf, hitting a target. Ping pong, hitting a target. Darts, hitting a target. Basketball is hitting a target. Soccer, baseball, bowling. I could go on and on. You look at almost every sport, it involves usually hitting a target or some kind of hand-eye coordination. And video games are really good at that. The satisfaction you get from playing tennis and hitting the ball and it going to where you want it to go, or playing air hockey or foosball or any little game or sport, there's a satisfaction from throwing a basketball and it goes in the hoop. Or you kick a soccer ball, it goes in the goal. So video games tap into that inherent enjoyment of hand-eye coordination. You're shooting people, you're shooting monsters. But I think it's the combination, though, of they are fun. You are hitting a target, they're challenging. They're not easy, and the challenge ramps up, and you have to think and use your brain and use your reflexes, and they really challenge you in many ways. Mm-hmm. And then also that sense of purpose. And you see some violent video games, they aren't, when I grew up, you had Mario and Zelda, and the games were really fun, but they weren't violent.
Yeah.
But I think the violence is really ramped up, where a lot of really fun games, they don't have gruesome dismemberment. You look at Donkey Kong, Mario, Zelda, Pac-Man. They weren't that violent, but I think that the problem with violence is that it's it keeps escalating. That shock value, right? Like shock humor, you have to keep getting more and more outrageous. Same thing with violent media, you have to keep getting more and more outrageous.
That's right.
You see this escalation. And one more thing, too, about violent media, just one more causal factor, I think, is lazy writing, where if you're writing a film or a television show, it's easy to write explosions. Mm. It's really hard to write character development and interesting drama and interesting suspense and conflict. And a lot of writers, they just throw explosions in there, and that's another thing. What I'm trying to say is there's many causal factors, and I think it's a complicated issue, but I have hope because I think that there's all sorts of reasons and evidence that we're going in the opposite direction. So.
No, absolutely. And I think obviously, you know, the manipulation that is going on in society has obviously tapped into that, that it does sell. It does, you know, today it's not a secret that people don't, you know, we seem to crave drama and negativity. Because again, the foundation set into society is fear-based. And as long as we're in that, we're going to continue in that vicious cycle that, you know, we see so much playing out today. However, the good news is books like people like you have written. And so when it comes to peaceful revolution, looking at the solutions to start with, what does peaceful revolution mean?
I think there's a transformation occurring. And the peaceful revolution has a lot to do with a transformation in how we see human nature, mm-hmm. how we see humanity. And I think it's a remarkable transformation where if an American politician today were to say that we should bring back slavery, bring back segregation, and women shouldn't be allowed to vote or own property, people would look at him like he's insane. But 200 years ago, that's how most people in America thought. That's how most politicians thought 200 years ago. I mean, 200 years ago, a politician would openly say, we should have slaves. Women shouldn't be able to vote or own mm-hmm. property. And that was the norm. But now, you say that at a party, you're going to clear out the whole room. People say, what's wrong with this slaves? What centuries have we been living in? And if we could create such a dramatic change in attitudes toward oppression of women or slavery in only a few generations, why can't we create dramatic change in mm-hmm. how people look at war or nuclear weapons or environmental destruction? And again, I'm half Korean, a quarter white and a quarter black, and I grew up in Alabama. You're a woman, and if we were living in America 200 years ago, I'd be a slave, and you wouldn't be able to vote, own property. And women back then, they were forbidden from speaking in public.
Oh, yeah.
And we have dramatic change, and if we've come so far, why can't we keep going in a positive direction? And I think the peaceful revolution, though, will transform primarily how we see things such as human nature, violence, peace, war, and how we arrive at a peaceful future.
Absolutely. Very, very well said. And it's like you said, you know, why can't we keep going further, right? Rather than drawing the line in the sand saying, nope, it's impossible, it's unrealistic, we should stop here. That's part of our nature, is to evolve. That's, you know, if we don't keep moving forward, we're basically going backwards or standing still and as in dying. One of the other parts that is part of the solution is, of course, in your book, you describe the different muscles of humanity, that when we become aware of them and when we exercise them, we become more empowered and more enabled to actually become part of the solution rather than part of the problem.
I can just give you a real quick example where empathy is seen as weak. Yeah. Empathy is naive. Empathy is weak. It's naive morality. Empathy doesn't have much respect. It's seen as wimpy, right? To have empathy, to have compassion is wimpy. It's not manly. And it's a weakness. And that's a huge problem because empathy is so vital for human survival. And one thing I saw in the military is how military units require empathy and camaraderie. When the military says camaraderie or brotherhood or cohesion, what they really mean is empathy among soldiers of that unit. And no one's going to call the military wimpy. Mm-hmm. And I do by calling empathy a muscle is empathy is a faculty. It's a human faculty. Like language is a human faculty. And language as a human faculty is very similar to a muscle because you have to strengthen it, you have to develop it, you have to strengthen it. As you're when you're a child, you have that elementary capacity for language, but you have to learn how to speak, you have to go to grammar school, you spend your entire childhood learning how to speak proper grammar, how to write effectively, how to communicate effectively. And if you don't strengthen that muscle, it can become very weak and it can atrophy. And the same is true of empathy. Empathy is a faculty. You have to develop it. You have to strengthen it. You have to train it. You have to practice it. You have to exercise it. But the thing about our culture is that not only are we not taught how to have empathy, I was never taught how to have empathy growing up by any kind of formal academic institution. Hopefully, people learn it through osmosis, just through watching other people's behavior. But not everybody gets that. But there is no formal training in how to have empathy. But the other thing is, so much of what I learned growing up actually made me have less empathy. I was taught to compete, to think of myself first, to be selfish, to be greedy, to, you know, the goal is to make as much money as you can at the expense of everybody else. And so much of what I learned growing up from society and from education actually taught me to not have empathy. Yeah. So not only are we not trained to have empathy, but so much that we learn does the opposite. And the other muscles, I think, are very similar in terms of hope, appreciation, conscience.
Yeah. So if you were standing, Paul, in front of, you know, the United Nations and could give them, you know, that one-minute message of what you would most want them to hear, what would it be?
Well, I think that we are constrained because there's so much misinformation out there. There's so much myth and illusion and deception about what is going on in terms of war and peace and what human nature is. It takes 10 minutes just to dispel the illusions, let alone offer another alternative. So in 1 minute, all you can really do is talk within someone's worldview and within their own framework. And anything outside of that framework will sound insane. Yeah. So I think you have to spend a little bit of time just dispelling that myth.
So how about when it comes to so many of the young men and women who are thinking of enlisting in the Army today? Do you have any advice or wisdom that you'd like to share with them?
The Army gives people 4 things that they really need. It gives them college money, it gives them health care, it gives them a job, and it gives them a pension. And we live in a culture where the Army is a 5th thing, even gives people meaning, where if you listen to President Obama or President Bush, the people in the military are spreading freedom and democracy and fighting terrorism and making the world safer. And maybe another thing the military offers is a sense of family, where I didn't grow up with hardly any family, and our culture has a very fractured sense of family, but the military gives you a real strong sense of family. So all those things together make it very appealing to young people. But I think you have to let people know what the risks and consequences are. You have to really be rational with them. And I've met a lot of young people where they feel that military recruiters lie, and they feel that counter-recruiters also lie. They feel like both sides have their own agenda, and they don't trust either side. So I try to just be level with them and just say, here, I want you to know what you're getting into, and I want you to know the reality of what might happen. And acknowledge the fact that the military has some good aspects, the military has some bad aspects. You need to make your own decision. One of the most dangerous things you can tell a kid to do is you can't do something.
Yeah.
They're going to want to do it more. The forbidden fruit, the when you make something forbidden fruit to people, they really... When it becomes forbidden fruit or taboo, for some reason, a lot of younger people, they want to rebel and they want to do it just to spite you.
Yeah.
So I have to let them know, okay, I'm not trying to deceive you. Here's the situation. Here are some good things about the military. Here are the bad things. And you have to make your own informed decision. Mm-hmm. And I think if you treat young people like an adult, we're talking people who are 17, 16, 18, I think that they will hopefully make the best decision. But what more can you? You can't force them not to join the military. And I have met so many people in the military, a surprising number, at least to me, whose parents were peace activists. Huh. And in the movie Restrepo, there's a guy in the film whose parents were peace activists, and he joined the military. And when your parents tell you not to do something, a lot of times it makes you want to do it more. So,
yeah, that's very, very, very powerful wisdom. And I definitely have to agree on part of, you know, not just teens, but even for, you know, younger kids or older, even for us as adults, you know, the more we get told, you know, something we shouldn't, perhaps becomes a little bit on the attractive side for us to, you know, explore and understand. I think the most hopeful part about today's youth, though, is that they are seeing through the insanity of the past. And so many in the young generation I'm finding today don't want anything to do with violence. And so they don't need to be sold on the military because they just understand that the world can operate in the mode that, you know, you are sharing and trying to teach people and spread the message of peace. To many younger people, peace and world peace, global peace, is not unrealistic. So when it comes then to your work continuing on, I know that you have another book that is going to be coming out eventually in the near future, and that is The Art of Waging Peace. Can you share with us a little bit in terms of what can we expect from that book?
My other books are a lot about human nature and a lot about the myths of war and the illusions of war, and creating a framework that can help us move forward. There's so much misinformation out there, and a very hopeful framework for how we can move forward. And The Art of Waging Peace is more specific on the actual strategies and tactics for waging peace. For example, how do you change how someone thinks? Mm-hmm. Someone is sitting across from you who has the opposite viewpoint, complete opposite viewpoint. How do you communicate with that person? How do you even remain calm? I mean, one of the most aggressive situations you can see are political and religious discussions. People get really aggressive when their worldview is threatened. How do you talk to somebody who has the complete opposite view of an issue that you find of the utmost importance, and how do you remain calm, not lose your temper, and even have compassion for the person? And then from that point, how do you communicate? How do you do more than preach to the choir? And if we look at how all change happens, every human problem comes from how people think.
Yes.
War, racism, sexism, slavery, oppression of women, even poverty comes from how people think, people's attitudes. And all change comes from changing how people think. So the reason I can't say that we should have slaves and women shouldn't be able to vote their own property is because it has become a completely unacceptable viewpoint to have in our culture. And that is because how people think has changed.
Yeah.
So how do we change how people think? In terms of war, environmental destruction, nuclear weapons, other problems. How do we continue that trend? And it does take training. It is almost, in many ways, a mental martial art. How do you defeat hatred? How do you defeat ignorance? How do you defeat ideas that are harmful to humanity? How do you have an idea such as women's equality defeat an idea such as oppression of women? How do you have an idea such as peace defeat an idea of war in the battlefield of ideas? And it takes training, and I think that in many ways the peace movement has lost its way, because what everything has to revolve around is changing how people think, transforming how people think about controversial issues. And we have to do more than preach to the choir. Mm-hmm. And once we're just talking to ourselves, you can actually see demonization ramp up. If you ever go on Facebook and you look at a liberal group, they're very demonizing toward the other side. And you look at Martin Luther King Jr., I mean, he was receiving dozens of death threats a day. His house was bombed. People were calling him, threatening to kill his wife and children. He was arrested multiple times. He was killed. You never heard him demonize the white oppressor. You never saw Gandhi demonize the British. You look at Nelson Mandela. He was in prison for 27 years, and he actually won the hearts and minds of many of his prison guards. Yeah. And they had great humanity. They had great spirit. And my concern is I want to be effective. I want everyone who works for these issues to be effective. I think people everywhere want to be effective. Nobody wants to be ineffective. We just have to get the right training. And I think that there's so much potential. And I have no doubt that we can solve these problems with the right training, with the right methods, and with the right knowledge.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, absolutely. And what is being covered through your books shows us both, you know, the problems and the solutions, which is what makes it so powerful, that it is leading us, you know, out of that state of fear and into a state of hope, empowerment, inspiration, etc. And so, aside from people, of course, becoming more aware and expanding their consciousness on these topics thanks to your books, what else do you recommend for the average everyday person? Perhaps they're listening to this, they're saying, you know, I have no direct experience or exposure to the military, I have no intention to do so, but what can I do on a daily basis to be part of the solution rather than part of the problem?
Yeah, I think one reason for writing the books is I've realized it is one of the most difficult problems is people have no clue where to begin.
Yeah.
And many years ago, I had no clue where to start. Where do you read? Where do you begin your reading list? I mean, there's a million books out there, and even books on war. If you want to learn about war, where do you begin? And so I try to summarize a lot of crucial content to give people a basic platform to begin their training in waging peace from. And beyond that, I think that I try to write in a way where I expose people to things that might interest them. I expose them to Albert Schweitzer or Gandhi or King, or in The Art of Waging Peace, I talk a lot about women's rights in the 19th century or Frederick Douglass, or I talk about a lot of, in the other earlier books, Eric Fromm and Hermann Hesse and Susan B. Anthony, where people can really, oh, I like that Albert Schweitzer quote. I like that Einstein quote. Let me look in the footnotes and see what book that's from. Let me read that book about Schweitzer. Let me read that book about King. And I think it's just basically giving people a foundation to start from. And one thing I use a lot is films. I think films and documentaries are such a powerful educational tool. And and then I would say just the combination of that personal transformation. I see two extremes in the peace movement where there's people who they talk about outer change and societal change, but they have no inner peace, so they're very angry and bitter and in many ways aggressive.
Yes.
People who talk about inner peace, but they don't talk about trying to change the system. And I think you need both. You need the inner peace, at least the effort to develop it, because it's a lifelong struggle to develop that. And you need the dedication also to transforming systems.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Susan B. Anthony, Frederick Douglass, all these people, Martin Luther King Jr., tried to transform systems. That's why you and I were able to have this conversation, is because women and African Americans are treated much better than they were because systems had transformed. And that takes a lot of dedicated action. I work for the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation, and we have a peace leadership program. And we're having a summer workshop about how to wage peace. And the NAPF website is wagingpeace.org. Again, that's wagingpeace.org. And my website is peacefulrevolution.com. Again, that's peacefulrevolution.com. And I have some resources that people might like to explore. There's a lot of good activist groups out there. I wish I could spend half an hour mentioning all the wonderful activists I've met and nonviolent training programs and peace education professors. But I hope that people will also look in their local community, find an activist group, find a peace studies program, and try to also pursue local education as well.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Because again, we can get involved. We can become part, as I always say, part of the solution rather than part of the problem, which, you know, is in action as much as also action. So by burying our heads in the sand or pretending things don't exist or being apathetic doesn't help anyone. So Paul, thank you so very much for taking this time to talk to us today.
Well, thank you for having me on your show, and I really, really appreciate it.
Oh, you're so welcome. And thank you also for the wonderful, wonderful work you're doing and being, you know, an agent of change and for the better, and of course to make the reality that I believe is going to be for many of us, perhaps even in this generation, if not for sure for future generations, where peace, world peace, global peace is going to be a reality. So thank you so much again, and thank you everyone for joining us. Until next time.